Hello and welcome to my final vidcast for this unit, where I want to focus on the issues surrounding the planning that's required to produce a research proposal. So my focus is on the research proposal as a concrete outcome of thinking involved with trying to come up with an approach to address a key resource or research issue. Now, when we think about proposals, what we're thinking about is we are thinking about crafting a document that actually tells an anticipatory story. It looks forward. It tries to convince the reader, who would be me in the first instance, and if you're doing postgraduate research, it might be a supervisor or two. But the goal of a proposal is to convince those readers that the proposed research is viable and that it is actually significant. It's something worth doing. It addresses a meaningful problem. And it just doesn't repeat what somebody else has done. It adds value in terms of what it will contribute. So it's important to recognize that that's one of the purposes, one of the functions of this particular document called a proposal. It's relatively short. It's not nearly as long, for example, as a published article would be, and it's certainly not as long as a thesis would be. It is a short story that sets forward your thinking about, here's how I will approach or how I would approach doing research to address a particular research issue. So the part of this document needs to convey the guiding assumptions that you're going to adopt in your research approach. It needs to convey sufficient detail about what you anticipate doing to gather the data, to deal with the data, to make sense of the data, and so on, so that the reader can become very familiar and make judgments about whether or not what you've planned is appropriate. Okay. And of course, in terms of this unit, the proposal assignment serves an additional function, and that is to evaluate your learning. So through the proposal, you will reflect your learning through the entire unit, from the start to the finish. And that's the goal. Okay. It's important to see this proposal as an anticipatory plan, but not a blueprint. Because we know now from our study of research methods, you can't possibly anticipate all the things that would go wrong. But what you can do is to try to set up as well-reasoned a plan as possible for how one might do things, how you might address issues, and what kinds of decisions you might make to address certain kinds of problems. And part of this story will also deal with reflecting your awareness of stakeholders and dealing with ethical issues if they apply to your particular research. So part of the story in the proposal needs to connect with research ethics and issues associated with stakeholder interests. Now, when you engage in the pathway for generating a proposal, if you think back to the research spiral that we discussed early on in the unit, and there was one version of the spiral that had boxes full of trigger questions all around it. And if you look at the mind map that accompanies this vidcast, you'll see that reproduced there, that slide. Well, those trigger questions are designed to stimulate your thinking about the research proposal and about the problem that it's going to surround in very concrete ways. So as you work your way around the spiral, you are thinking in a more and more detailed yet logically consistent way about how you would do research on this particular issue that you've identified as important to study. And while you're developing that plan, you have to keep in mind your guiding assumptions, because what you do has to be consistent with the guiding assumptions. Those guiding assumptions will have certain paradigm-specific criteria that your project would need to meet. So, for example, if you're doing a positivist investigation, you know that issues like internal validity, external validity, construct validity, they need to be addressed in the proposal, and you need to display how you will deal with those issues and how your study will in fact acquire quality against those criteria, and where the trade-offs have been made between internal and external validity. If you're doing an interpretivist study, we know that the validity criteria are not really relevant, but criteria such as transparency, authenticity, sufficiency, and possibly transportability. They become important to deal with, and the research needs to reflect awareness of that and to put in place procedures to enhance the achievement of those criteria. And then, of course, there are the meta criteria that can be layered on top of this, so that you can, in setting up the research context for your problem, you are displaying contextual sensitivity. When you're building your story through your lit review, you are juxtapositioning your proposed research against the work of others. When you talk about where you are sitting as the researcher, you are positioning yourself. So some of you might be doing research in your own organization, so you are not only a researcher, but you're also an employee, and you needed to think about what that dynamic will do that's different from somebody who is researching an organization or a business from the outside, or somebody who is doing research using secondary data sources. The researcher has different positionings. So as you unfold your thinking around the research spiral, addressing these trigger questions, the map of your proposal begins to unfold and the logic begins to grow. So that when it comes time to unfold the actual story, we can build that thinking into a reflection of the key features that one would expect of a proposal. And a good research proposal, number one, has to be written very clearly. It has to be written in appropriate language for the target audience. In our case, it's an academic readership that's going to be primarily looking at your proposals, namely me. So you're writing needs to be clear, it needs to be a readable story, it needs to be logically coherent, it needs to hang together. It can't come in bits and bits and drabs, it needs to read as a coherent story. The project needs to be seen to be feasible. Is it doable? And that's one reason why we ask you to present a timeline and a bit of a discussion about the kinds of resources you'll need, because that will influence this feasibility sort of issue. There's a requirement to do a little bit of a lit review. It's a very small scale, very brief. Only the really immediately key relevant areas that you'd want to touch on, the relevant resources and bits of literature, to help you build the case for your study. What's the gap? What's your study going to contribute? How will it add value? That's what that conveys. And in addition, having that literature review there helps build the logic for your research questions. So your research questions should logically emerge from the discussion of your lit review as it then intersects your anticipated research context that you will have discussed. The biggest part of any proposal, of course, is the methodological story. That's the big chunk. What will you do? How will you gather the data? How will you get access to your various sources of data? How will you select them? All sorts of issues surrounding the sampling question. How will you gather your data? Will you use a survey instrument? Will you use semi-structured interviews? Will you use systematic observation? What will you do? How will you gather the data? How will you record it? So if you do semi-structured interviews in an interpretive study, you might do an audio recording of all the interviews, but then that creates the need to generate a transcript. So you have to have a phase that says, well, before analysis can proceed, I need to develop a transcript. And I know from our previous work in qualitative data analysis that part of the transcription process is building up the rules for what gets transcribed. So you need to think about, well, what is it I'm going to want in these transcripts? And how might I unfold those? How much time will they take? That will influence where you position it in your timeline and how much time you allocate. And we noted in an earlier discussion that for about 1 hour of interview, recorded interview, it could take 3 to 4 hours to generate a usable transcript. So that can give you a way of multiplying up to get an estimate of the time you'd need to allocate to that activity. You need to factor in the need to perhaps do some kind of a pilot test or preliminary trial of your methodologies to make sure that they work. If you're doing an interpretive study, trying out your interview techniques on a few people. Make sure you're comfortable with those interview skills that you have. If you're doing a positivistic investigation, you might pilot test your draft survey or other instruments that you're using. Make sure that they're functioning appropriately, that the instructions are clear, and so on. So there's that component of the story that's important to get at as well. A good proposal will unfold all of these methodological details, including some indication of the kinds of analyses you might anticipate using on the data, whether it's quantitative analysis or qualitative analysis. Now, since this is not a unit in data analysis, we don't necessarily expect a lot of detail here, just some very high-level helicopter-type thinking. I've got to compare some groups, so I need a group comparison technique if I'm doing a positivist quantitative study. Or if I'm doing a qualitative study with semi-structured interviews, I might use a computer support tool like NVivo to help me identify some of the themes that people are talking about, that kind of thing. Part of the proposal, especially as we've configured it for this unit, is that it contains an appendix where you have a first go at drafting the instruments you might use if you're doing a positivistic investigation, or unfolding your semi-structured interview topical landscape, or maybe telling the story about the secondary databases that you plan to access for your particular research. So you build in a description of those databases. What are their contents? How would you get access to them, and so on. That's all appendix material, as are drafts of things like cover letters for getting informed consent from participants, a letter maybe that you would use to try and pass a gatekeeper to get access to doing research, let's say in a company. You might have a letter to the CEO. So your appendix will have drafts of these different kinds of components that you might envisage using. Okay? And then specific to the proposal that you're developing for this unit, I want you to reflect on what you see as the strengths and limitations of that proposal, so that you are aware what you've done that makes it strong and what you've had to give away in terms of creating limitations in order to make the project doable. Okay? And there's actually a component of the story. Now, to facilitate this, because writing a proposal is not the world's easiest task, the assignment description actually provides a concrete structure for you to work within. You have to use that structure. There are certain expected topical headings and components to the proposal. A short executive summary. Here's what the proposal is all about, half a page or less. Then you want to develop an introduction, which sets the context for your study, builds up the literature story, evolves the research questions and/or hypotheses as appropriate, positions yourself as a researcher. So that's all part of the introductory aspects of the proposal. Then there's the research design component. That'll be the biggest chunk. And that's where you may use a series of subheadings to talk about, well, who will my participants be? How will I sample them? How will I gather my data? What will be my data gathering strategies or procedures? How will I record my data? How might I approach the analysis of the data? How will I handle ethical issues and getting access to my data sources, passing the gatekeepers, and so on? All of that is part of the research design story. And there you would include brief discussion of the stuff that you've put in the appendices, and you would do a brief discussion of what you might anticipate doing to the data once they are in a form suitable for analysis. And the final part of that story will be a sketch of the timeline that you think the study would have to go through, and the kinds of resources you would probably need to carry out the study if you were to do it. The timeline, you can do that on an Excel spreadsheet or just use some kind of a graphical thing. Some people use a table just to show the breakdown of the different components of the study and about how much time is going to be devoted to each component. And obviously, if you're doing a proposal that is intended to be a draft of what ultimately might become a thesis or dissertation project, then part of that timeline has to be factoring in the time you need to write up this thing and deal with supervisors along the way. So that's part of the journey as well. And then toward the end of the proposal, you want to have a coherent section that does talk about the strengths and limitations of your proposal. You reflect on what you have just put forward. Where do you see the strengths? Where do you see the limitations? Because I want to see that you can critically reflect on your own work, your own project that you've put forward. And then, of course, don't neglect references. Adopt the appropriate referencing style. And for our school, it's either the APA style or the Chicago author date style. Get yourself up to speed with that. Use one of the styles so you're consistent. And appropriately utilize the style for dealing with direct quotes. So if you directly quote somebody, treat it as a quote. And remember, there always has to be a page number in the source that the quote was taken from. And that has to appear as part of the citation. So that it's always very clear where quoted material is coming from. All that has to be apparent and solid and clear. And then there will be the appendix material at the end. And that will differ depending on the nature of your project, the guiding assumptions, and a whole range of other considerations. Everybody's appendix will be different and will have different kinds of pieces in them. So bottom line for a research proposal, for the purposes of this unit, you are using it to convey your learning in this unit. And it may have a secondary benefit for those of you that are doing a postgraduate research degree, in that this gives you a chance to do the first draft of what ultimately might become the proposal that you actually do your research on. If you're not in that kind of a situation at the moment, then your proposal stands as of, well, this is something I could do in the future at some point. And you want to make it stand as rock solid as possible. So whichever way you go, this proposal will have that kind of functioning. It really is your final exam in the area of research methods. So I wish you luck in tackling this activity. I think you'll find it challenging, but also rewarding, and it will put all of your learning into play as you begin to formulate and shape this thing. Thanks very much.